The following program is brought to you by Caltech.
Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. I'm Aris Rozakis. I am the chair of the Division of Engineering and Applied Science here at Caltech. And it's indeed my great pleasure to welcome all of you to tonight's Watson Lecture. Before I introduce the speaker, I would like to remind you that our next speaker in this lecture series is Professor John Preskill, who is the Richard Feynman Professor of Theoretical Physics and also holds a joint appointment in computer science in engineering and applied science. And his talk is entitled Quantum Entanglement and Quantum Computing. Now, going back to today's business, perhaps some of you are already wondering why the chair of the Division of Engineering and Applied Science is here introducing a lecture on earthquakes. So this is not strange at Caltech. It is indeed the beauty of Caltech. You'll soon find out that here at the Institute, we are very proud to foster truly interdisciplinary research and teaching activities which sit exactly at the triple interface between mechanics of materials, dynamic fracture mechanics, and earthquake seismology. Indeed, our speaker tonight is Nadia Lapusta, who holds the unusual title of Professor of Mechanical Engineering and simultaneously Professor of Geophysics, thus belonging to two academic divisions at Caltech, one being engineering, the other one geology and planetary sciences. Now, Nadia grew up at the Ukraine and was subjected to the substantial rigors of the Soviet educational system in pure and applied mathematics while attending Kiev University for her undergraduate studies. She survived all of that resulted as an excellent applied mathematician who went on to go to Harvard University at Cambridge, Mass, and study under the guidance of Professor James Rice, a famous fracture mechanician who, according to many of us, is the father of the field of fracture mechanics. Now, a few years later, she produced a truly remarkable thesis. It has long been known that dynamic frictional sliding is a very unstable and intermittent process. And it has long been speculated that there is a link between this instability and intermittency and natural earthquakes. Now, that instability and the intermittency have made it very difficult to rigorously understand the exact process of sliding. And this has remained an open question for decades. Now, Nadia Lapusta changed all of that through her thesis work. Indeed, she found a way to model and to analyze the dynamic sliding process and showed that a sliding system can have events that are extremely fast in microseconds, while also being quasi-dormant for centuries. And she was able to model this in the computer for the first time, including the area, the times of dormant behavior and the times of dynamic seismic, intense seismic activity. Her research discoveries effectively enabled us to establish the long speculated link between the mechanics of sliding and natural earthquake events while paving the way towards a more rigorous approach to earthquake prediction. Of course, we are not quite there yet. Now, following her thesis and her doctorate degree in 2001, she continued on at Harvard as a postdoctoral fellow and she joined the faculty at Caltech in 2002. And I cannot stop myself by claiming at least half of the credit of attracting her here. Professor Bhattacharya, the executive officer of mechanical and civil engineering, who is sitting right here, often claims the other half. So since coming to Caltech, she has continued her unique brand of research on using rigorous principles of mathematics and mechanics and dynamic fracture to understand the processes of earthquake nucleation and rupture propagation, and has concentrated on difficult scientific questions such as rupture speed transitions from subrayleigh to supershear, as well as slip mode selections from crack-like to pulse-like rupture modes. She has received the prestigious NSF Career Award, and she currently serves on the board of the Southern California Earthquake Center, known as KEC. Nadia has applied her ideas to laboratory earthquakes as well as to multiple real-life situations, the latter being the topic of her Watson lecture today. It is now my great privilege and personal pleasure to invite Nadia Lapusta, one of Caltech's most accomplished seismomechanicians, to deliver her lecture.
Thank you very much, Aris, for your kind introduction. And good evening, ladies and gentlemen. And thank you all for coming. Tonight, we are going to be talking about earthquakes, and specifically about how we can build theoretical model of earthquakes and then simulate their behavior on a computer, and then what those simulations can tell us about the actual earthquake process. So the common notion of earthquakes is that it's ground shaking. When we think about earthquakes, we think about ground shaking. And we also know that earthquakes can produce a lot of damage. And here we see some examples from recent earthquakes, in relatively recent earthquakes in California. I'm not going to cite numbers about how destructive earthquakes are. We all know they cause great toll in human life and destruction of property. And we can go on the web and find it all on Google. So instead, I'm going to concentrate on these science questions. What causes the shaking? Why are earthquakes difficult to predict? And if the earthquake prediction is difficult, and some say impossible, what can we say about the future? So the theories of why earthquakes and, you know, shaking occurs dates way back. And this is one of the theories coming from the 19th century Japan. And they believed that there is a giant catfish, Namazu, living under the island and periodically shakes it. And here people are trying to punish it for the earthquake in Tokyo in 1855. Of course, our thinking evolved since then a little bit. We don't think that earthquakes are caused by catfish, at least not in Southern California. We think that the earthquake is due to shaking, and the shaking in earthquake is due to rapid shear rupture in the earth. And as the plate motion occurs, so across a plate boundary marked here with a dashed white line, the two sides are rapidly moving past each other, generating waves. So what we will see here is a simulation of an earthquake done by in Southern California Earthquake Center. It's the shakeout scenario that we are all supposed to pay attention in October every year. And so we see how as the rupture propagates along the fault, it generates these waves. And what is shown here is the peak ground velocity. And then the waves spread, you know, across California. And for example, when they get over here into the LA Basin, the basin continues to reverberate because the rocks here have lower density for a while. So the earthquake by now is gone. The wave fronts are still propagating. And you notice how much LA is shaking. And also there is another basin up there in Oxnard. All right, so now it's 2 minutes, 16 seconds after the beginning of the earthquake. The earthquake is gone, the waves have died off over there, you know, the LA Basin is still shaking. So this is the sort of thing that can happen in the next earthquake. It's what they call a plausible scenario. It's based on a lot of research about historic earthquakes and things like that. So we would like to contribute to the understanding what earthquakes are plausible by understanding what is the physics of this phenomenon. Of course, we know that it's caused by the motion of tectonic plates. If we start by with the world map and we put a bunch of recent events on the map, we see that they cluster into these objects and kind of outline plates that cover the Earth's surface and constantly move relative to each other with very, very slow rates. And they are actually like an eggshell in terms of their relation to the Earth. They are very thin, but you know, they're still several tens of miles in many places. And so if you zoom in onto the boundary that we are most concerned about, between the North American plate and Pacific plate, we live right here in California, okay, we see that we see the sense of relative motion of the two plates. And if you zoom in even further, the boundary doesn't appear to be very simple. So we see here a bunch of faults, many faults. The yellow dots, the ribbons represent the faults. The yellow dots represent seismicity. And it's not, it looks rather complicated. Now, the good, in fact, I love this SCAG t-shirt logo. And so indeed, we love California still. But the main player in the system actually turns out to be this yellow ribbon over here, okay, the San Andreas Fault. It's the one that accumulates most of the relative motion between the two plates. And all the others are actually a kind of byproduct, side damage, if you will, resulting from the, the deformation, and the largest events occur along this yellow ribbon here. So let's take a better look at this ribbon in a surface map. And so here is California. The San Andreas Fault is now the only surviving line here. And so we see these red areas. They mark the portions that are currently locked. So the plates are kind of chugging along at several inches per year. And these boundaries are locked. So of course, at some point, they will have to catch up with the plate motion. And that's what will cause earthquakes. Now, there is also a little curiosity here, this little segment. It's not, of course, so little. It's about 100 kilometers or maybe 60 miles long, shown here in blue. And it's actually creeping. So this segment is actually moving along with the plates. It's not locked. And you know, wouldn't it be nice if the entire plate interface were like that, right? If it all were creeping along and not really accumulating this deficit and raising it in earthquakes. So the obvious question, right, an interesting question to ask is why? Why do we have this creeping segment? And also on these locked segments, when they start moving, why are they moving fast? Why can't they simply, you know, catch up slowly, right? Maybe faster than the plate motion, but kind of catch up slowly. So why do they accelerate? So we can ask both of these questions. And to answer them, we have to now take a look at the details of what happens under the hood of this machine that creates earthquakes. So here we have a schematic cutout, right, from that thin shell from the Earth crust. So, and of course, the obvious ingredient is the plate motion. So one plate is now represented by this block. We kind of try to map it in three-dimensional view. That's, well, this block would belong to Pacific plate. This block belongs to the North American plate. They try to move in opposite direction. And of course, they are stuck on this plate boundary, which we call fault. The next ingredient is the elasticity of the rocks around this fault, right? If they kind of turns out they store energy just like a spring would. If you compress spring, it stores energy, and then you let it go, it kind of flies on you. It's the same happens with these, the same happens with these rocks. And so they see they get deformed, as shown here by these curved line, and they also the elasticity also provide long-range interactions, so that if one point here moves, it's as if everything is connected by a bunch of invisible springs. If one point here moves, everybody else around kind of feels that motion, first through waves and then kind of in a static sense. So it's it looks kind of completely still to us, but it's actually a very interactive system. And then there is fault friction. So here we look at this interface. And turns out that from the surface motion, we can discern that it's not the entire interface that's locked. Actually, there is only part of it which is locked, so-called seismogenic zone, which is about between 3 and 15 kilometers, so about maybe 2 and 10 miles. And then the deeper portion of the fault is actually creeping along. Okay, so the deeper portion is actually well-behaved. it's kind of creeping along, and as this top remains locked, it's accumulating this relative shear motion over here. Okay, now the very shallowest parts are also creeping in many places. We can kind of see that on the surface, but in some other places they are locked. So again, we see this interesting curiosity. We see both creeping and locked areas, now in a kind of depth-dependent way. And incidentally, we have friction because we have this depth-dependent compression, which is meant to be shown by these black arrows, right? Just like as you go down in water, you have pressure around, right? And when people want to go to great depths, they need protective equipment because they can be squeezed by that pressure. The same in rocks. As you go down, there is this pressure of the weight of the rock on top of you, right, which is actually pressing the two plates together and creates friction. So if you press half a pound together, the more we press, you know, the harder it is to move them past each other, the larger the friction is. And so there is a lot of pressing here by the rocks. And the rocks are kind of very hard to deform, but the plate motion is doing that for you. So these are the basic ingredients, and let's see how they will interact to create earthquakes. So let's just, in a cartoonish way, understand what does it mean that, you know, an earthquake happens. We're going to put here a little fence, and because it's a, well, monster fence in a way, because it's exaggerated, right, compared to these depths. This is 10 miles, so, you know, it's a, like a 3-mile fence. And so, but for visibility, we have to make it that big. And now I'm going to just, you know, let the rocks kind of release their deformation. So they release that deformation, they straighten out. And, you know, now this part of the surface juts this way. And, of course, the poor fence is broken. Okay, we can put it back, and we can do this earthquake dance. Okay, and so this relative displacement here from what the fence experienced and how this fault juts out is what we call final fault slip. Okay. Of course, here is just a cartoon, so I'm doing that instantaneously just by pressing a button. But the process itself, right, is not instantaneous, but it is very rapid. And this rapid process generates seismic waves, which we can measure in seismograms. So the whole medium is shaking, and we can record that shaking. This is actually an acceleration measured close to the fault in a Denali magnitude 7.9 Denali earthquake. That's an integrated record to produce velocity of how fast the Earth was moving. And you know, it has this, these, the duration is not marked here, but it's really in seconds. So it's a very rapid process. Incidentally, when you look at this picture, you're thinking, who would build the fence across the fault, right? Well, there is a photograph of that. Of course, people didn't know they were building across a fault, okay? But here is just like in our cartoon scenario, here is a fence. Okay, and it just was happily sheared, and in fact, you know, we can see this relative motion, and this is not an invented picture. This is what happened in a portion of 1906 San Francisco earthquake. It's a very famous photo, and it shows you can actually go and measure, right, or you could when this fence was in existence, and you can say these two parts moved past each other by about 8.5 feet. So that's what also geologists do, right? You don't, you know, how many fences across a fault you would have, right? I mean, not many. But you have other features like that. You can have streams. So when streams flow, they create beds. And when the earthquake happens, it displaces these beds. Also other geologic features. And you can maybe map them on the map. And that's how you can map even without, you know, measurement equipment. You should go in some places along the fault and map, you know, see this evidence for the fault moving rapidly. But by displacing these features like a fence here. Okay, so back to our San Andreas fault picture. There were more markings here than I described previously. So these are the previous large events that are marked. You know, from here to here is this 1906 earthquake that displaced that poor fence. And then there was a small earthquake here in 1985, and then there is an 1857 magnitude 7.9 earthquake, the most recent magnitude earthquake larger than magnitude 7 in southern San Andreas Fault, and then there is this section over here, which actually last time it ruptured was somewhere in the 1700s, okay, so 1600, 1700s. So it's a long time, it's like more than 300 years that we didn't have an earthquake on this part of the fault. And this is exactly where the shakeout scenario was. It started somewhere in here and kind of ran up along this part of the fault, which we consider to be most ready, right, for the following earthquake. So how do we know whether it's ready or not? We can make this average computation of average repeat time of large events. We can say, well, a large event would accumulate 5 to 10 meters of slip, so 3 times that in feet, 15 to 30 feet of slip. And then we know the plate motion, it's inches per year. We can just divide one by the other and say that on average, to catch up with the plate motion, the earthquake should occur about 125 to 300 plus years, okay? And actually this little segment over here exceeded now all these calculations, right? So in that average sense, okay, it's ready. Of course, we haven't had an earthquake yesterday there, and we don't have it today, so obviously not yet. But this average calculation tells us it's getting there. So now let's go back to this question, right? Okay, we have these locked segments, we have this creeping segment. Why? We also saw this depth-dependent behavior, locked portions, creeping portions. So what is the basis for that? So to understand why some segments are locked and why some segments are creeping, we're going to go to this very simple analog system. It's called spring slider system, which is kind of a Poorsman version of an earthquake. So of an earthquake system. So what do? You replace, you know, the plate motion with a very sad turtle because, you know, it has to drag up a block. Then you replace the elasticity of the spring of the rock with spring. Okay, it's a very simple analog. Then you say the fault friction will be represented by a friction between the slider over here and the base, and the compression for the friction is actually provided by the slider weight. So very simple system, and we can see how the system will behave. Okay, well, one can actually compute it without even a computer on a piece of paper using some very simple equations. And what you see is that as the turtle is moving and the spring is extending, and this yellow arrow is representing the spring force, and there is a friction growing here. The friction tries to balance the spring force, and then it stops. Okay. And so, and it was supposed to continue doing that. And so basically what we would see is that at some point, what was supposed to happen, I think it's a wrong version of the movie, but what was supposed to happen is that when this spring extends, it matches up with this friction over here, and then the friction would suddenly drop, okay? So we don't have that movie here, but we can imagine this friction suddenly dropping, and then the mismatch between the two arrows, right, would generate a net force going in the direction of the turtle. And as we know from the second Newton's law, the net force means acceleration. So the block would actually accelerate, and that explains why it wouldn't be kind of a slow catch-up. It would be a fast catch-up. The block actually accelerates, almost hits the turtle, right, and that's what creates an earthquake. So the key aspect of that behavior is that that red arrow was supposed to abruptly drop, and it didn't, and you know, just like natural earthquake, unpredictable, right? So so this arrow was supposed to rapidly drop, and then we would have this mismatch. And so the key feature of this system was supposed to be that if friction weakens with motion, okay, if during motion the friction weakens and creates this mismatch in forces which translate into acceleration, then you get earthquakes. So first, the system stays locked for a while, accumulating this forcing, and then it suddenly catch-ups in earthquakes. Okay, so what will happen then if the friction was not weakening with motion, but rather stayed constant, or for example, was strengthening? Well, hopefully this turtle will cooperate more. Let's see. So here it's a little different. It's still the turtle is moving, and the spring is extending again, and it's slow climb, right? Slow tectonic loading kind of representation. And then here, right, when the maximum peak friction is reached, you know, friction has peak value, then, you know, the block, there is no mismatch at no point. The block simply starts moving, right? The forces are always matched. And so the block is simply then moving with the plate rate, right? According to the Newton's first law, which is if the two forces are matching, the net force is zero, and you just have steady motion. So basically what we've learned from these two cartoons, and we would learn even more from this cartoon if it were the right cartoon, but basically if the friction is weakening with motion, then we would have locked portions and then earthquakes. And then if friction is strengthening with motion, after some initial period of loading, right, the block just keeps moving. So, and that of course leads to stable motion or creep. So now we can ask, you know, how is it happens in a real system? And obviously, right, since we have these locked areas and these creeping areas, then this is a key for us that friction indeed evolves with motion on real faults. And in particular, what we would say is that we would say that these locked portions are weakening with motion, and these creeping portions are either not weakening or strengthening with motion. So this is our kind of frictional property prediction. So what happens if you want to really find out how the rocks behave, right? All these spring slider models are good, but how about studying the real stuff? And actually people have done that, scientists have done that. And so you can think of taking, if you think of a cutout, you know, in the earth, kind of normal to the fault. So this is your fault trace and you are cutting out a piece of rock and you don't want to do it right at the surface because the surface is actually very weird condition. It doesn't have a lot of compression, right? Because it's right at the surface. And as you go down deeper, the compression is higher. So somewhere deeper in the earth is much more representative of how the entire fault feels than, you know, just the surface. And so you wanna think you're deeper in the surface, in the earth, and this is the fault trace, and this is the rock around, rocks around, and they always have some cracks. Rocks always have some cracks in them. And then as you go close to the fault surface, these cracks kind of intensify, and at some point there's a lot of cracks. And then right at the fault trace where the earthquakes occur, it's really very pulverized. It's almost completely pulverized. And so this is actually how the actual rock looks. To us, you know, it looks just like a piece of rock. To a geologist, you know, it's a mine of data. But even we can see that, you know, there is this kind of line over here, and the striations in these rocks are this way, and here there is nothing like that. So it seems like these are two different kind of rocks that came from two different places. This is the scale of 5 millimeters here, this black line, so 2 inches, okay? And these arrows are meant to represent, you know, how the plates are moving. This is actually, you know, a boundary between two moving blocks. And when geologists look at something like that, they study it and they say, look, this first rock here is deformed, but there is no relative shear. It's not having any shear surfaces. Same here. So the entire relative motion is just accumulated is this narrow surface, okay, almost like a surface, narrow layer, inch wide maybe or less. And you have miles of relative shear motion on that one little surface. And so these, there are several studies, so it's really incredible how thin are these zones where the actual shear occurs, almost like an actual mathematical plane. And so it turns out that earthquake slip may be occurring in these very narrow layers of basically rock powder, okay? Because after this miles of relative shear motion, the rock here is completely what we say pulverized. And actually the mean particle size is 1 micron, you may ask. What is 1 micron? That's actually a typical size of a bacteria. So bacteria is typically micron size. And so 1 millimeter is about 1/25 of an inch. So this is kind of that order, okay? And then 1 micron is 1,000 times smaller than that. So try to imagine that, right? Or else a bunch of bacteria stuck together in this shearing zone. Okay, so, but actually, It's good for our science because you can actually imagine studying response of a layer like that, right? If you don't need to know how vast rock expanses behave, if you are concerned about the behavior of this layer, you can actually do it in a lab. So it turns out you can determine relevant friction laws by studying such narrow layers in the lab, and people have done that and came up with this notion of rate and state fault friction that I will tell you a little bit about. So the experiments are done in very kind of massive machines because you're trying to reproduce, right, this large compression of the rocks and you have to apply these large forces which are generated by tectonics. So this is schematics of one of such machines and there is a little animation that goes with it. So as one of these pistons is used to compress the sample over here, And so then you see these powdered rock layers are these are shown here as these yellow layers. And then the other piston is pushes this middle block, creating relative shear. So actually you do like a double shear experiment. You can interrogate kind of two of these samples at the same time. And you try to determine what is the behavior, what is the resistance to shear as you do that, right? So you can compress with different compressions. You can move with different velocities here. And there is a version of this apparatus where this entire thing is embedded in a vessel and filled with fluid so that you can do these experiments in the presence of fluid, like water or CO2. Because very often in the Earth crust, you have these fluids present, okay? And so you want to know the behavior also in the presence of those fluids. So as we move on to the results, what do we see? Well, so what you measure is the resistance to motion, right? So that resistance is shown here in a kind of normalized sense. So this is resistance to motion divided by the compression you apply. And this is very so-called friction coefficient, and values around 0.5 or 0.6 are very typical for many materials, not just rocks, but also wood, plastic, metals, other things. And so what you see in this experiment is that they were moving at one velocity, and then they abruptly switched to a different velocity. And at one velocity, you see this semi-steady level of resistance. And then at another velocity, you see another semi-steady level of resistance. Okay, and so you say in that sense, well, it's velocity dependent. It depends on this velocity. And sometimes velocity is called rate. Okay, so then you say rate dependent, and that's what is rate referring to here. So there is a dependence on rate, how fast you move. Well, there is also this entire curious thing over here, this evolutionary effect, and you need another variable to describe it, and empirically first, and now we have some physical understanding, state variables were introduced to explain this additional dependence. These state variables actually thought to describe how this powder feels at the contacts, right? So we have a bunch of particles that are contacting over these small areas, which are very highly stressed. And so that state variable is describing the population and evolution of those contacts. So we're not going to concentrate too much on this evolution effect. We're going to concentrate here on this rate dependence. There is another curious thing is when you just hold, okay, your sample, you just put the sample in, you compress it, and then you hold. You hold a second, and then you do an experiment, or maybe you hold a day and do an experiment. And some enterprising people were even holding it for a year, right? It's obviously not on this plot, and then doing an experiment. And then you see that the friction systematically increases with this hold time. So, of course, if you ever try to move some object like a jar in the kitchen, sometimes it gets stuck, right? Well, sometimes it's just a jam or something that's in it. But sometimes it's the strengthening, right, of friction with time, especially if it was sitting there for years. So basically, we also see that friction increases with time when there is no motion. And in fact, you would think now you have to introduce time as a variable as well, but scientists have been able to link it, this behavior, to that same evolving state variable. So that's why this law has just rate and state dependence in it. I could show you the equations. I personally think they're beautiful, but you may not agree, so I'm not gonna do that. Okay, so now as we move along, so what do these experiments discover? Basically, they find that there are two types of rock friction behavior. One is so-called velocity weakening friction. So this friction coefficient, kind of in that steady state sense, after all these evolutionary effects, kind of basically decreasing with velocity. And we have a very special, so-called logarithmic scale. We go from inches per year to inches per day to inches per minute. Right, so it's not a very linear scale. And on that logarithmic scale, it's kind of almost like a straight line. So as the slip velocity increases, friction decreases, so fault weakens, hence the name velocity weakening. And some other kinds of rock actually have velocity strengthening behavior. So it's the opposite, right? As the slip velocity goes up, the friction actually increases. And as we've seen from the turtle movies, okay, or the turtle systems, spring slider systems, this kind of behavior, the friction weakens with motion, right? So we get long periods of locked situation, and then we get earthquakes because of the acceleration that's caused by weakening in friction. And then if we are in this sort of behavior, then we get creeping motion. So the actual rocks have these properties. So you may, in fact, I'm not going to talk much about it, but these evolving state effects are also very interesting. And in fact, they give this notion of nucleation size. In other words, when the earthquake initiates somewhere, as we will see in the models in a minute, it's not just immediately runs away, but there is this small period of time when it has to slip very slowly in a small area. And after that, it kind of accelerates and runs away. And this small area is called nucleation size. And there are also all sorts of interesting things about it, but we are not going to talk about that today. Now, what we will talk about is why do we have these velocity weakening versus velocity strengthening behavior? And so factors that favor this velocity strengthening behavior in experiments are, first of all, low confinement. So that's why you may have them next to the free surface. Second of all is high temperatures. And then certain types of rocks just happen to be velocity strengthening. In fact, this sort of behavior was actually discovered through experiments because in everyday life, right, mostly we think the friction is weakening. We mostly think about static kinetic friction, and it's harder to start the motion, but then it's easier to continue, you know. And so in everyday conditions under room temperatures and everyday confinements, most surfaces are actually here. They are velocity weakening, okay? But turns out that, you know, we can have this velocity strengthening behavior under these kind of conditions. So and it jives perfectly well, okay, with our little schematics here, because we can say, well, here there may be some creep because it's low compression, and here there may be some creep because it's high temperature. As we are getting down in the Earth, the temperature here is higher by about 300 degrees Celsius than on the surface, okay? And then if we look through this fault, we can say, well, maybe here there are some special kind of rocks in this little segment. And in fact, there was this CIFOR drilling project done right over here, San Andreas Fault Observatory at depth, and it did find very special minerals there that presumably are not present on the rest of the fault. So far, so good, right? We kind of understand through these considerations why these different portions behave different way. So how can we now put all of this together and not just rely on the spring slider example, but really simulate how this block of Earth would behave under all these assumptions? So again, we have tectonic plate motion. We have elasticity that stores energy and also provides Lorentz interactions. And we have this rate and state friction, which is acting on the fault zone, right, which is variable in space and also have these interesting dependencies in with slip and relative motion. So how do we build such earthquake source models? Here is a recipe, okay, of sorts. I could put a bunch of equations, but let's instead look at these pictures. So we need the equations of how the rocks would move, right? How the rocks move under deformation and so on. And we get them from these areas. Basically, they are a little overlapping, continuum mechanics. Solid mechanics is part of it. So basically describe the mechanics of continuum media. And then applied math is where it's all started. In fact, a lot of mechanics equations were developed by famous mathematicians of the past, Lagrange, Euler, and so on. And then we need these friction laws, so we get them from laboratory experiments, and I'm showing here kind of a rock sample sheared in the laboratory. You see this prominent surface created just like in the sample from an actual fault. And these are actually analog experiments where an actual earthquake is produced in the laboratory, done in the laboratory of Professor Aris Razakis, who introduced me today. So, and this information about the frictional properties comes from rock physics, geomechanics, and material science. Then we need to understand how to simulate this on the computer, so we need numerical methods to evolve these systems, and generally speaking, computer science, and this is a picture of a supercomputer that we have in the basement of the Geological and Planetary Science here at Caltech that we are using in my group. And finally, when you get this all going, you need to compare to observations. So we have GPS observations, which are GPS stations, just like you, many of you have GPS in your car. So then even more precise stations are communicating with satellites and find their positions very accurately. And then we can plot very slow motions. We can track very slow motions that way. Of course, we have seismic information in terms of seismograms and historic data about past events. And so disciplines of geodesy, seismology, and geology deal with this kind of information. So and then, you know, we mix this all up. So we put the equations together with the frictional behavior, put it all in the computer, and try to compare with observations and improve on models so that they agree with observations better and better. Of course, no one can be a specialist, or some people can, but I certainly cannot be a specialist in all these areas. So you have to collaborate with a lot of people. As Aris mentioned in his introduction, it's a very collaborative field. So in terms of observations, you know, some active collaborations I have here at Caltech and some outside Caltech, but I will concentrate on Caltech ones, are with Professor Jean-Philippe Aouak, who studies these actually geodetic motions and also geology of faults. Then Professor Pablo Ampuero, who is a seismologist here in the seismological laboratory, interested in earthquake physics and seismological methods. And finally, Hiro Kanamori, also a seismologist and actually a pioneer in the field of earthquake seismology and earthquake physics. The very moment magnitude scale that we are using, when we say magnitude 7.8, magnitude 8.0, the very scale was developed by this man right here. Now, in terms of the experiments, I have collaborations with Professor Aris Razakis, actually he has a lab here at Caltech where these earthquakes are produced on a miniature scale in a kind of analog system that's much more realistic than our spring slider, and one can actually use that system to understand dynamics of large events that would be very hard to do in a natural environment. And so we collaborate on designing these experiments and also modeling them. Then Professor Kaushik Bhattacharya, who is interested in material science and microstructures of materials, and of course, as we've seen, these shears happen in a very narrow layers, highly pulverized. There's a lot of microstructure in there. And so we try to collaborate on understanding the micromechanical aspects of friction. And finally, Professor Hossein Drada, who is a geomechanician interested in granular media, and some of you may have been to his, may attended his Watson lecture, I think it was in October. And again, because of these powders, they're basically very fine granular materials. We have started a collaboration trying to understand their response better. So we do this loop through all these disciplines, and we want to apply all of this to this poor block right here. And in mathematical sense, again, there are a bunch of equations, but in mathematical sense, what we're trying to solve is that we have these elastodynamic equations of motion in the bulk, and this nonlinear fault friction on the fault as a boundary condition. It's called a boundary value problem. And then what we want to get out is simulated time-dependent motions everywhere in the system, okay? So let's see how that works. So we will give a couple of examples of such simulations. So first, we will concentrate on something small, okay? So, because these models are maybe 10 years in existence, right? So they are baby steps. So what we are trying to simulate here is this very little segment, okay, between this yellow dot and this black line called the Parkfield segment. So this is actually a visual of the Parkfield area. Of course, it doesn't have these green fields, but this is a simulation coming from the model that I will be talking about. So it's a very interesting area because it's the closest we've ever come to try to predict earthquakes in Southern California. And that's because there is this series of magnitude 6 events that keep happening in this small segment. So historically, we know there was one in 1881 and 1901 and 1922 and 1934. Okay, and then there was one in 1966. And this one was actually relatively well recorded because there was already a seismic network in place. And so on the basis of this observations, I mean, they are not very regular, but they're all magnitude 6. They're kind of semi-regular. There was this attempt to say that, okay, maybe we can now make a kind of a prediction that's going to be a next event in about 20 years, okay, because that's about the average recurrence time over here. So in the early 90s, people were very excited, and they had the so-called Parkfield prediction experiment going, where they said they're going to be an earthquake. They're going to be a magnitude 6 earthquake in the early 90s. So they've instrumented this area quite a bit with seismic networks and these GPS networks and so on. So thanks to that, we have a lot of information. And then the earthquake did happen, but it happened in 2004, okay? So on the kind of average recurrence time of 20 years, it overshot that by a good 10 years. So you see that it actually happened sort of 30 years late. And in the early 90s, there was a series of events, but these were much smaller events. They got this name of the seismic crisis or something like that. But basically, somehow they've disrupted, right, this large event from happening, and it happened late. So this is the sort of, right, unpredictability that you have even in this simple system of this little segment over here. But also a great place to apply your models, right? Because the behavior is relatively regular, and we have a lot of information. We don't just know the recurrence times. We have a whole host of data, of different data sets. And I'm just showing some of them here, just to convince you we have many. But so what we have here is basically GPS measurements of interseismic velocity, how the fault moves before, how the fault moved before the 2004 earthquake. And so we see these arrows clearly show the motion of the two sides. This is Pacific plate and this is North American plate. And as you go closer to the fault, you know, this motion decrease, just like you know, the fault is stuck. So the motions decrease. Now they are a little higher here. They don't go all the way to zero because of the creeping segment, okay? There is a creeping segment just to the north. And then based on this and many other sets of data, people, scientists have made inferences of what actually happens on the fault interface itself. So this is depth going down into the earth in kilometers. If you want miles, you have to divide this by about 1.5, so this would be like 10 miles. And so the gray color shows inferences of what, how the fault is behaving, moving based on these lines. And so you see that black is the motion with something like 2 inches per year, 37 millimeters per year. And these gray colors are slower motions. And the black dots, by the way, represent micro earthquakes, much smaller earthquakes, maybe magnitudes 2 and 3 earthquakes that occur in this area. And these red counters over here actually represent the area that moved in the 1966 earthquake. Okay, so you see how that area very nicely fits between those kind of dots. And if you think dots are not, you know, these dots, basically the locations of them are somewhat uncertain because these are small events, their locations cannot be completely accurately determined. So these lines may be much sharper actually in real life, you know, than they appear here. Or it could be cloud like that. But it looks as if these small earthquakes almost mark boundaries, right, between one kind of behavior and another kind of behavior. White, by the way, is locked. And, you know, the earthquake kind of fits somewhat right between there. So we can try and create a model that would have properties motivated by these pictures and would try to reproduce the behavior of the segment. So let us first see this movie. Okay, so basically we had the review of almost everything I said before, apart from friction. And so how does that calculation comes about? So we use the equation of motion in the bulk with some standard rock properties. So the most interesting part is the fault itself. So this is, we are looking straight on the fault. This is the depth of the fault, and this is along the fault. And these are the kind of friction properties that we assume. Remember we said there is velocity weakening, there is velocity strengthening. So based on that information of how the fault was moving before 2004 event, we choose right, the velocity weakening properties and the velocity strengthening properties on this fault. And we picked the values from representative of laboratory experiments on rocks. And then, so once we set the properties of fault friction, we can actually try in a computer to actually turn the plate motion on and see how the system would behave. And so this is what will be shown in this movie here. So this is the same kind of view straight on the fault. And what the colors would indicate is the how rapidly the two sides of the fault move past each other, okay? So the I should have marked the scale, but the red would actually be earthquake-like rates, very fast rates of about meters per second or several feet per second. And then the black is actually locked, and the blue is actually creeping with the plate motion, okay? So right now in this snapshot, we see there is this locked area, okay, where we are gonna have an earthquake, and that's because it's velocity weakening, so it's locked before it has an earthquake. And then these velocity strengthening areas are kind of mostly creeping around this area. So let us see how that behavior would evolve in time. So this is already, the simulation was already going on for some time, okay? And what we see is that something is trying to speed up over here. This is this notion of nucleation size that I was briefly talking about, but it kind of fails. These dots is just the microseismicity that occurs, okay? And then we have another attempt at enucleation, and you know, something tries to nucleate. It's a kind of a slow process. We don't feel that process. And then an earthquake starts, right, and kind of very rapidly spreads across the fault. You know, the whole earthquake, this is about maybe something like 20 kilometers, and the earthquake propagates with 3 kilometers per second, so the whole event is gone in 7 seconds. And then we have some accelerated slip around, which is now also gone. It's called post-seismic slip. And now this is like a typical interseismic period. The fault is locked. You know, around the fault, we have this creep. This is the seismogenic fault in this case. And you see, we have all sorts of slow motions going on, and then eventually they will lead to another nucleation, which will have an earthquake propagating the other way. And so these two stars are actually showing the actual nucleations of 1966 and 2004 event. So our model has these spontaneous transitions between nucleating in one corner of the model and then the other corner of this locked area. So let us see what these simulations match, right? They match quite a bit of things. Given that we don't use the properties from the actual rocks down there, because we haven't been down there, we don't know, right? These suggest representative properties from the lab of kind of rocks that we think might be down there, right? So there is, of course, uncertainty. So this is, for example, how magnitude 6 earthquake, what kind of surface motions it would produce. So the simulated motions are in blue, and the actual measured motions before and after 2006 events are in black. And you see we have some pretty good agreement, and maybe somewhere it's slightly off, but overall, you know, it's looking good. Then after an earthquake, there is this fast but not really seismic motion in some parts of the fault, and the GPS stations react by these kind of signals of the order of year, right? So these are some, the black again is the data of the GPS signals, and the red is what our model produces with the same friction properties as used for the earthquake itself, right? It's a model that reproduces all of it. And so we see that, again, that the agreement is pretty good. And also, like I mentioned, if you take a cross-section through the middle of the fault and kind of show earthquake as these dashed lines, so this is slip accumulating on the fault, this is one earthquake, this is the next earthquake, this is a third earthquake, and then mark where these, you know, initiate, then we kind of reproduce this transition from one nucleation site to another, and also there are some intermediate sites events that occur between such transition happens, which is exactly what we've seen between 1966 and 2004 event. So far so good. It seems like this model using laboratory data and our notion of how rocks behave reproduces quite a bit of the behavior of this little segment, okay? So it's looking good, but it also has limitations, okay? And here is one of the limitations. So if you plot, you know, the kind of expected distribution of recurrence times, remember we said 2004 event had a recurrent, you know, occurred maybe 30 years plus after the previous event, and some of these other events were closer spaced. So basically the average recurrence time, the black is observation, the average recurrence time is about 20 years, but it's very widely spread. And in our simulation, the average recurrence time is also 20 years, but it's a much more narrow spread. Okay, so clearly we are not matching the variability of the system. And there can be a number of reasons for that. And we can use this model, we can improve this model to include other factors and see what they will do. First of all, and I will briefly talk about this next, is this notion of friction being even more complex that we have heard so far, and also the role of fluids, that actually there is evidence for fluids next to the Park Field segment. But also maybe our model is not heterogeneous enough. Okay, we have some heterogeneity, but not, we don't know how to properly put small scale heterogeneity yet. And also we're just studying one fault segment, so perhaps it's interacting with other segments, because like I said, the entire crust is like an infinite bunch of springs that connect all points to all other points. We think it's just doing nothing there, but it's actually interacting. So let's talk a little bit about, in the remaining couple of minutes, about this notion of dynamic weakening. In fact, if you plot the collection of results on friction coefficient, so here you have friction coefficient plotted for a whole range of slip rates. You know, the rate and state laws were formulated basically based on the values over here. But in many of these experiments, as you go to much faster rates, which is more challenging to do, you see this dramatic weakening as represented by these dots falling down here. And what could be a reason for that? Well, one reason is shear heating, okay? Is if you are cold, right, your hands are cold, you want to rub them. And this is a thermogram of a person rubbing hands, and you see how the hands are getting warmer. So, you know, earthquake is like an intensive rubbing of hands, right, just going one way, and very compressed. And so what you have is that this rubbing generates shear frictional heating. The frictional heating increases temperature right on the fault. And when you slip fast, that happens fast, and so it has more effect. And first of all, it can just affect the material. For example, the material can melt. But even before that happens, if you have fluids, okay, on the fault zone, then the fluids will kind of expand because, you know, turn into vapor, for example. And at that point, you're basically like riding on a cushion of steam, right, with the fluid pushing apart the solid particles and creating a much easier ride for an earthquake. So we call that additional weakening. So this is all explained in here. But an important feature is rock permeability. So we introduce yet more important rock properties. It's because as this fluid expands, the question is, will it be trapped in the fault zone, or will it actually be just squeezed into the rock around, right? So if the rock is permeable enough, if it's like a sponge, it may just soak up all that expanding water and nothing will happen. So whether this sort of mechanism, for example, will be acting or not depends on how permeable the rocks are. So not only now we need to know these friction properties and so on, now we have to know that. We have to assess the sponginess of rocks, if you will. And again, people have done that, scientists have done that. And here we are looking at another earthquake, a very well-studied earthquake in Chichi and Taiwan. So this is the motions recorded in that earthquake. The blue color is slow, small emotions, and the red are large emotions. This is just relative motion plotted on the fault, which in this case is inclined. So here we had all the way something like 10, 12 meters of slip, which is about 30 feet of slip. And so they actually took the material from this part of the fault and this part of the fault and actually measured the friction properties. And what they found is that the friction properties are very interesting. So on this part of the fault, it's this velocity weakening. So kind of unstable behavior, susceptible to this earthquake nucleation. But the rocks have high permeability. So this fluid-like effect is not going to act in here. But on the other side of the fault, the rocks are actually velocity strengthening. So they should be stable. They should have no earthquakes at all, except for they have low permeability, so they are susceptible to this additional weakening, and you see this area generating a lot of slip. So we can ask, we can try to put properties like this and see what they do in our models. An interesting side note, and don't worry if you don't care for this sort of thing, the areas of a smaller slip over here had actually much more high-frequency radiation. And high-frequency radiation is really this sharp, very changing radiation that occurs. And normally, you know, this kind of radiation just scales with the size of the slip. So really, smaller slip having more high-frequency radiation is kind of unusual. So it was a very interesting earthquake from that point of view. But then the same sort of thing occurred in the Tohoku-Oki earthquake, and this is a much more serious earthquake. It's a magnitude 9.0 of Japan, so this is Japan, and this is the interface earthquake fault of Japan, and we are again plotting the slip in color that occurred in this magnitude 9.0. And so there was this area of extremely large slip, okay, 50 meter plus slip. This is like 150 feet of slip. It's by a factor of two or so the largest slip we've ever had before. And then the high frequency radiation that's shown with these colored dots are kind of coming from the other portion of the fault, okay? So something like that happened in this earthquake as well. And so there were all these other observations like extremely large slip and also complex rupture pattern and so on. So it turns out that if we incorporate these fluid-like effects in our model, we can explain these observations. And basically what we do in this model, we take two patches on the fault, right? One patch is having these properties like measured in one part of the Chichi earthquake in this southern part, okay? So it's weakening at slow slip rates and maybe a little bit more weakening at fast slip rates, but not really much. And this other patch over here has these interesting properties, right, where it's strengthening at slow slip rates, so should be stable, but then seismically it can dramatically weaken. Okay, and so we can ask what would be the consequences of these properties. So let us look at this movie. Now again, it's a little bit different color scale, but the red now represents the creeping velocity, the white and blue represent seismic slip. Okay, and so what we see, say, at this point is this portion is locked, and the portion around is creeping, and then there are all sorts of transient slips trying to nucleate earthquake in this model, and then, okay, nucleation occurs here, doesn't quite penetrate into the second patch, okay, so this is a small event. Then the nucleation will occur again. Let's just wait for it for a second. So as you see, kind of like a living thing, you think the faults are just sitting there. By the way, years of simulation passed by, the next earthquake happened. These movies have very variable frame rate because you want to do interseismic periods, which are hundreds of years, and then you want to do an earthquake, which is, you know, tens of seconds. So, and then finally we will see this area is completely creeping. You think it's completely safe, it's creeping, and then an earthquake starts here and ruptures that creeping area in a pretty spectacular way. So this is when you include the fluid properties, the behavior becomes even more complicated. And in fact, we can show how this matches the Tohoku-Oki and Chichi fault behaviors in a good way. So an important question that then comes from this is that, how about our creeping segment over here, okay? So far in our emergency preparedness, we kind of assumed that an earthquake would not propagate through this creeping segment, that the creeping segment is kind of safe, that it separates the southern San Andreas fault from the northern San Andreas fault. And so if a large event occurs on the southern San Andreas fault, it will kind of stop here, and the event on the northern San Andreas fault will kind of stop there because this creeping segment will keep them separated. So if in fact it can fail, then we may have an earthquake that propagates through the entire fault system, and then of course two large metropolitan areas will be affected by something like this. So how do we know whether it will propagate or not? Of course, we need to understand more about the physical properties of that segment. We can study whether there was rapid large slip in the past. Geologists can try and do that. Now we can drill through the depth of that segment and ask how wide is the shearing zone. Will the shear heating be effective? Because the narrower the zone, the more effective the shear heating. And finally, we can assess these fluid-like effects. We can ask how permeable the rocks are down there and will they trap the fluids or not. So there is a lot of work to do. And also there is a lot of work to do for improving our models, and that's why I'm very fortunate to work with a very talented group and very industrious group of students and postdocs, many of whom are co-advised by my collaborators at Caltech. And we're also grateful to our funding agencies, NSF, United States Geological Survey, Moore Foundation, and Southern California Earthquake Center. Finally, let's ask this question. What should all you guys do, and us as well? Well, we should be prepared, right? No matter what kind of earthquake happens, we should be prepared. So we should secure our furniture, we should make an earthquake kit, water and medicine be important survival items. And during an earthquake, we should drop, cover, and hold. And if you ever wonder why, here is a movie over here of actual an entire wooden structure put on a shake table and you see San Diego and shaken with the kind of motion that Northridge earthquake produced. Okay, so notice how, you know, there will be a TV flying out over there. So let's just see that happening. And now for this so-called children's bedroom. So obviously, you know, no one wants to be on the receiving end of any of these falling objects, right? Because they will be moving with the kind of earthquake-like velocities. We are talking feet per second. Imagine your TV running into you at feet per second, right? That's not a pretty picture. So we should all be ready, you know, to not have that. And finally, let's quickly assess how we are doing in our questions. So what causes the shaking? I think we've got the pictures, this rapid shear motion in the Earth. Why are earthquakes so difficult to predict? Well, that's because of their nature, right? They're just, the earthquake mechanics tells us that. So an rupture can nucleate in a small favorable spot, like you've seen in those movies, and then spread like a fire. Okay, and here is an example, right? These are just snapshots from the last movie I've seen. The rupture starts here and just propagates along the fault, or not, okay? So it may start in a favorable spot, okay, and then just stop like this. And you look at these two pictures, okay, there's a little bit of a mirror image in here, but nothing is very different between these two pictures, okay? And so the state of the fault is actually very similar, and these very small changes, subtle changes in this interactive system that prevent this much larger earthquake from happening in the second case. So the prediction is difficult because earthquakes are part of this highly interactive, nonlinear evolving system. And elasticity provides both short and long range interaction that complexify the system all the time. And then fault friction, as we've seen, varies in space and time and with fault motions. And then there are fluids, shear heating, and heterogeneity, perhaps on very small scales, that you know, are very, will be hard to account in an exact precise way. So that's why exact precise prediction, like the earthquake is going to happen tomorrow at 2:14, you know, in such and such portion of the fault, may not be, may be very difficult, and in fact may be impossible. I mean, we cannot prove it's impossible, but it certainly looks very difficult. So if you cannot do that, then what can we do, right? What can we say about the future? And one thing we can say for sure is that future large earthquakes will not be like the past ones, okay? We know that from experience, okay, because every time there is a new large event, we discover something new, it's nothing like the previous one. And that's because the system changed, the state of the system is different, the friction evolved, the loading elastic forces evolved, right? It's definitely not gonna be like the past one. So while we have to assess our preparedness by looking at past events, that may not be the only strategy that we would want to pursue. So that's why a ray of hope is that we have now this better and better understanding of earthquake physics. As I have shown you in our models, for example, we are doing better and better at reproducing all sorts of behaviors. And of course, when we further develop these models with other factors and simulate more realistic scales, then potentially we can determine not just what has happened, but what might happen in the future, right? We will know what kind of events can occur, what kind of shaking they can cause, and while we will not know which event, when exactly will occur, we can be prepared for all of them. Thank you for your attention.